The topics are importance of industry mentoring, industry academia partnership, future of AI jobs, and employability skills. We are live on the Insta too. May I request the online participants to please post your questions in the chat so that after the panel discussions, your questions can be answered. Thank you. I'd like to give a small brief introduction regarding the panel members we have here. Firstly, to talk about, we have Uday Shankar Pollavaram, sir, and he has worked on real-time projects like laser-based manufacturing process automation, IoT-based home automation solutions, smart wheelchairs, robotic manipulators, SCADA-based solar streetlight automation, haptic gloves, and many more. Sir is going to talk about automation and AI technologies. As the next panel member, we have Mr. Bharat Kumar, sir, Director, Nova Labs, US. His aim is to bridge the gap by providing skill development programs in the AI training and research space by bridging the industry-academia gap. As the third panel member, we have Ms. Komal Sharma Talwar, ma'am, founder, director of TT Consultants. Ma'am is also a co-founder of ExcelPat, a product company which is a technology search and analytics tool having the world's largest and most intelligent technology database. As a third panel member, we have Ms. Laina Emmanuel, ma'am, co-founder of BrainSight AI. She has worked with the Clinton Health Access Initiative NetApp. Ma'am, along with her co-founder, Dr. Rimhim Agarwal, has introduced MRI-based diagnostics for psychiatry. As a fifth panel member, we have Mr. Adarsh Natarajan, sir, CEO, founder at Aindra Systems. He's working on developing a point-of-care cancer detection platform that has as its heart an AI engine. We welcome you for the panel discussion, dignitaries. And I would like to first of all invite Ms. Komal Sharma Talwar, ma'am, to discuss on a day in the life of a data scientist in an AI company. A day in the life of a data scientist in an AI company. Ma'am, please. Yeah, ma'am is going to address us on employability skills. Ma'am.
Hi, lovely to be here. Thank you for the warm welcome. So I'm largely an entrepreneur, and I work very, very closely with innovators. I started a IP consulting company while I was in law college, and we worked with all the Apples and Qualcomms on their IP strategy. Over a period of time, there was a lot of buildup of AI technologies which were coming into different industries. And a few years ago, some of our customers started telling us that, you know, there's a lot of AI coming in, say, healthcare, in the financial markets. Why is somebody not looking at AI in the innovation world? Because there is so much data that can be leveraged for data-oriented decision-making there. To just give you a summary of what the innovation data globally looks like right now, about 5 million patents get filed in the world every year. We're sitting on about 100 million technology documents there. There's a lot of research papers, publications that come out to the tune of 250 million documents. And when companies, universities, innovators are looking at these data sets, the spend annually is about $1 trillion. Now, the problem that we saw when I was consulting with a lot of innovators across the world was that innovation was not democratized. when you go in for a pattern, the processes are so manual, time consuming, so data driven, so data heavy, that everybody does not have the money strings to be able to spend on quality innovations. And that's when, just through my passion of wanting to democratize innovation across the world and having a platform where every student, every innovator in the world could get access to data and get actionable intelligence out of it came out. So we innovated. My second passion really is my second business, which is Excel Scout. We are the world's largest technology database. And what we really work on is we collect all the world's documents which relate to innovation, different innovation connections. For example, if a student is suddenly going into the field of surgical instrument, right? How do you, at the glimpse of a button, realize what is happening in that field across the world? There you need different data points. You need to know what is happening in the world of patterns so that, you know, if you're coming up with a product, you're not infringing somebody else's technology. You also need to see what are the international publications which are coming out so that your research can be more guided at a certain stage. If you're looking at collaborations, you need to also find out what are the startups, the large companies, mid-sized companies working in that area. You might also need funding information about which companies are funding that innovation. So what it really does, it accelerates innovation at a very, very early stage and gives you the power of data so that you can make decisions early on in your product development or in a place like an innovation lab. My experience with AI has been, you know, we've implemented AI at all the international patent offices. We work with about 300 companies globally on AI implementations. We work with all the leading universities like Fraunhofer, IIT Chennai. My experience really has been that AI might be a buzzword, but you have to really create a kind of a value proposition for AI within the vertical or industry that you're working. And two things which hold back adoption of AI in the world right now in different industries is, number one, explainability of AI. So a lot of AI technologies right now are black boxes, right? So what we worked on our platform is that when you're kind of running a search, do you know on what basis is that algorithm running? So we've tried to bring explainability of our AI algorithm so that the user has control of what he's getting. And number two, accuracy. We have to still work a lot in the world of AI on accuracy levels. The algorithms that we have right now are at a 95% accuracy, which are really, really rare in the AI world. But I think till the accuracy levels do not increase, the adaptability of AI is going to be low in most industries. Because when you're spending, you know, like when you're taking decisions which are based on millions of dollars, you have to make sure that you can back on the AI decisions. As an industry, I think it's going to really boom. And I would really encourage a lot of women to get into technology. It's really nice to see so many women here who are doing engineering degrees, because I really believe that this is going to be the future. With the number of jobs, you know, being rolled out in the world of engineering, AI in the world, this is going to be really one of the highest paid industries. And as a woman, I feel this is going to be a great way of gender balance in the future. Because these are highly paid and lucrative jobs. So women in tech is one of my passions. I do a lot for it. And I would love to, you know, kind of work with the college on any projects where we can promote women in technology. Thank you.
If the panel members want to discuss on this, any points from the other panel members?
Great work. Just wanted to kind of understand, when you're talking about automating the whole IP landscape in terms of search, prior art search. So I'm sure a lot of automation in terms of AI, NLP, and all of that is coming into the picture. So do you kind of also extract data that can be used by the inventor to kind of understand where he stands vis-a-vis the existing inventions that have already taken place, and then kind of navigate that space? And is it completely automated, or do we still have any human intervention?
So that's going to be a little longish answer, but we have different applications. The one which is currently being used by a lot of universities and the Indian Patent Office, we call it a novelty checker, where you know, you don't need to be an IP professional to be able to use it. Anyone in the audience can use it. It's a natural language processing based search. You put in your idea in very simple English language. And it's the through NLP and machine learning, the system is able to extract all the patent documents across the world which are close to your invention area, and is able to give you, say, a top 10 patent list, which you need to look at very closely, because that could be something you could be infringing in the future if you, you know, if you kind of file a patent application. We always say that the last mile is still the human strategy or your attorney's take, but definitely, I think at least the first 50 or 60% of the process gets automated. And also what that does it for a student or for a professor, it also helps you to ideate. So we have an ideation machine, which tells you how strong your idea is, and also gives you suggestions of parallel domains of what ideas you can integrate within your idea for the patent grant rate to increase. Then we have the world's largest problem data set, where we've extracted what problem a patent addresses from all the patents in the world. So very quickly, if you're working in the field of, say, you know, a 3D sensor, what are the problems being addressed in that technology right now? You can see at the click of a button, and you can also see what companies across the world are working on in that area. So again, you can solve your R&D problems faster. You basically have all the world's data, which is helping you to assist in decision making and to accelerate your decision making.
The reason I ask that is because we engage with our own IP lawyers, who charge us a bomb, right? right. And the reason they do that is because their whole thought process is how to make the patent language as ambiguous and wide-ranging as possible, so that, you know, you kind of catch all of that. I'm sure you know this day in, day out, right? So how well does this automation actually be able to navigate that kind of language, which is not very focused or not very specific, but very broad and very kind of wide-ranging?
We're not working in the space of helping you to draft those patent applications. There are some companies in the world that are doing it, but I can very proudly say that we are the only company in India right now. So we're about 10 companies in the world right now who are working in the space of AI and patents. And what we are doing is we are telling you whether you should be filing that application or not. So what the system will show you is that the area might be so crowded, and you'll be able to see patents in the area very quickly. Also, that helps you to increase the quality of the patents that you're filing. So I'll give you an example of how IIT Chennai came up to us and said, we want to increase our filings, but we also want to increase the quality of our filings. Now, there are small tech transfer departments in every university. It's just 3-4 people who are handling a vast number of ideas that come from students, right? And therefore, every idea is not able to get the right attention. And you might be filing patents, which you, if you do a thorough search, you would actually not file. So the software here is enabling those tech transfer departments to get smarter, where they're able to throw the prior art at you very quickly. So you're able to spend more time on ideas which are actually better. And the students have access to that software. So they're also doing a lot of due diligence before you come to the tech transfer department or to the professor, because they have a very realistic view of what's happening in that technology and prior art before they come up with an idea for a patent application.
Thank you. So one of the points which you brought up about the explainability of AI, which I think is a very important topic for everybody here. We struggle, obviously. It is a very important thing in the healthcare space. I wanted to understand if it is the same across different industries beyond healthcare, and what are some of the frameworks, thought that's going on around this particular topic right now.
I can only speak about how we've handled the issue of explainability. It'll be wrong for me to comment on maybe, you know, what's happening in your field or his field. So I'll give you an example of how we handle explainability. So we have this application which is called a landscape module, which basically if you put in a technology area, it kind of tells you what's happening in that entire technology area globally in terms of pattern trends and other things. Now, the way other softwares were using this, were launching this app was that you basically put in your ID and you got a lot of graphs through Lingo, which were completely automated, right? So if I have to decide whether, as a company, if I'm trying to decide whether I should enter a new technology area, millions of dollars of decisions are riding on it. And I'm not sure whether the AI algorithm at the back end was able to put in, you know, extract my key concepts, my keywords correctly. Was it able to navigate all the patent documents through the right NLP technology to give me the right set? So what we've done very smartly really is we call it the human curated AI assisted taxonomy, where the human being, the expert, spends about 10 minutes on defining their categories and some categories of the technology. And we've developed the world's largest technology dictionary, which gives you ideas of what are the concepts being spoken about in those patents. So you get assistance from the world's largest technology dictionary. You get a lot of assistance from AI in terms of additions you can make to your idea. And here we see that the users are much, much happier adopting the technology because they know exactly what the system looked for when it kind of categorized those lakhs of results into thousands of results. And we also saw the accuracy levels jump from 50 to 95%. Right? So I think explainability will, for human beings to trust AI, I think explainability is a very important factor, and each one of us has to see how we can make the algorithms or the calculations that happen at the back end with the machine explainable to the users who are using it so that there's more trust in it.
Absolutely with you. Thank you.
Career boosting AI skills.
Okay, hi. Good afternoon. Can you please raise your hands who's saying AI is a magic? Does anyone feel so? Yeah. Yeah, everyone feels that it's a kind of a magic. You plug in something and you get an output, and that's something totally different. See, the first and foremost thing is you do not have to have an extraordinary skill to become an AI engineer. Okay, that's the number one. People always feel that becoming an AI developer is something rocket science, and you can't get those skills, in quite some time. Please understand, when we were doing our engineering, we didn't have any chance to speak with industry people in the first place. We never saw any kind of industries coming to the college or having an interaction with them. And I have never seen any such vibrant institution who is doing all this for you. So please do not use and utilize the maximum. When you talk about skills, I would say, people will say you have to learn math, programming languages, and then statistics, probability, neural networks. You can say a lot of skills which is go to AI. But in my opinion, you please understand where does your strength lies, which is suitable for you, and where the industry is going. In 2019, it was around $6.4 billion that was the AI market share in India. And right now it is $10 billion, which is almost 1,000 crores. And people always have a saying that, freshers, engineering freshers, we do not get any jobs easily, something on those lines. See, I'll give you a statistics. In 2019, there were around 6,000 fresh engineering graduates who were recruited for AI. And the last year, it went up to 12,000. It's more than 100% last year. So it's about your knowledge, your dedication, and determination. And you can see all the entrepreneurs who are working in the healthcare AI space and who are working closely with us too. So please try to utilize as much as possible. I might be good in the healthcare probably. Someone will be good in manufacturing. Someone will be good in finance, corporates, and everything. So you just try to understand what is the domain that you have to go with. And it's not like, even though it comes under the broad umbrella of computer science, artificial intelligence is completely a multidisciplinary. You don't have to just learn computer science. You have to learn a little bit of other things which is coming from your industry. I'm not a biology student, okay? When I started with AI and neuroscience, I have to learn neuroscience a lot, to be frank. So you just choose your domain, which is, which is subtle for your exposure that you are getting. Do a lot of projects, okay? Anything and everything that's on books is good. And please understand there is a wide gap between the industry and academics. That will be, the gap gets shortened when you do a lot of projects along with the industry. Okay, and probably I would ask Adarsh to add some, because he recruits a lot of AI engineers very frequently. So I would ask him to, he was talking about an AI engineer asking for, some amount of exorbitant thing for, NLP engineers kind of thing. So I would ask him to share his thoughts how the interviews will be. Over to you.
Thank you. Yeah, thanks, Bharat. So just a quick background of what we do at Aindra Systems might help set the context of the kind of talent that we look for. So we are in the space of let's not talk technology, but the space of detecting cancers at the point of care. And not when I say point of care, not necessarily in metropolitan cities which have very good healthcare systems, but we are looking at really tier 2, tier 3 towns and cities and even rural places. Our vision is that we want to become the gateway for good health outcomes to the 5.8 billion people across the globe who lack access to good health systems, right? That's our vision. And to realize that, we are trying to work on systems that can go closer to the people and help them get better health outcomes rather than expecting all of them to come to centralized healthcare facilities. So that's what we do. And for us to be able to realize that vision, we use a lot of convergent technologies like artificial intelligence, of course. And along with that, we also use a lot of optics, mechatronics, a lot of convergent technologies, including cloud. So that's in a nutshell of what we do. Now, coming to the point that Bharat raised, this is a great time to be a student. Trust me, I feel so jealous that I've kind of passed that stage, but this is an amazing time for you people to be studying when a lot of technologies, be it AI, be it IoT, crypto, a lot of emergent technologies are all bubbling up at such a rapid pace that you people are spoiled for choices. I mean, the world is yours for the taking, trust me, right? I mean, that's the whole point, right? I feel so jealous that I'm like 20 years late, right? Or 20 years too early. So coming to the point, so there's so many plethora of technologies that are emerging every other year probably and becoming so hot that you guys have a great opportunity to kind of go for that. Now, and he's right, the demand also in the market for people who can contribute in extracting the value out of those technologies is very large. And I was just telling him over dinner yesterday that companies, big, large, small startups, everyone are in a mad rush to find talent who can actually contribute in their growth stories. What this has given rise to is an enormous demand has given rise to atrocious asks for salaries, which is great from a candidate's perspective. So I think you guys are in the right time. So grab that opportunity, get your fundamentals right. I think guys like Uday and Bharat and all are there to guide you in terms of getting your fundamentals right. Become employable to the industry as soon as you pass out, And I think you have a great management here who's supporting you in that journey. So I don't see anything else amiss here. It's just your ambition and your drive to, you know, realize that ambition, which will take you places. In short, I don't see this trend going down for the need for people, great talent in any of these emergent technologies going down for the next decade at least. So I think this is a great time. Go for it. All the best. Good luck. Good luck to you guys.
Any points from the panel members? Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you. May I request Mr. Uday Shankar Kollavaram, sir, to talk about the state of AI industry in 2021.
Can I have 4 students on stage, please? 4 students, fast. Fast, come on. So we've been using a lot of words, AI, NLP, machine learning, big data, data analytics, so many big words. But these are all very simple technologies, something which we do every day, day in, day out, but it's just that we don't realize. Okay, one of you go to the lamp. You go there. You come next to me. And you can come to the center of the table. Okay, so on the count of 3, you can stay where you are. On the count of 3, I want all of you to converge in front of the camera at the same time. Okay, in front of the camera on count of 3 at the same time. Ready? 1, 2, 3. No, not you. Only those 3. Once more. Back. At the same time. Not before, not after. Right? 1, 2, 3. Okay? Now go back. Can you do this with your eyes closed? Can you do this with your eyes closed? Yes? Okay, let's try. Close your eyes. 1, 2. Okay, how many of you think they'll bump into each other? Raise your hands. How many of you think they'll just like that pass and go? They won't converge at all. Raise your hands. Okay, so how many of you think they will, one will reach first, one will never reach? Very good. So we have different options. Let's go. Close your eyes. So she'll be the judge. On the count of 3, 1, 2, 3. Okay, you can open your eyes. Okay, go back. The same thing with your eyes closed, but the only difference is she is going to help you. Do you know the names? What's your name? Okay, your name? You heard? Your name? Okay, she'll help you do the same thing. Again, on the count of 3.
Count pandren, okay va?
All of you same thing, but she will count, eyes closed.
Okay, shall I start the counting? 1, 2, 3, go. 1, 2, 3, stop.
Now help them to count the same.
Little bit more, Rishikesh, like little
eyes closed,
more.
Eyes closed.
Can you repeat it again? Come back. Yes, sir, one more chance. Okay. I will count down and stop when you, I will stop you, then you should stop there, okay? Follow my counts. 1, start. 1, 2, 3, 4, stop. Famita, 1 step back. Triloka Chandran, 1 step forward. Little bit left side, right, left side, move. Okay, Rishi, 1 step forward. Okay. Is it okay, sir?
Okay, thank you, guys. You can stay here. A round of applause for your friends, please. Okay. Now, to understand this entire setting, these three people are three different tasks which we perform regularly. Now, with the eyes closed, when they work, this person guiding all of them is your AI system, your artificial intelligence system. So what is actually happening? Now, for AI to happen, first thing, machine learning has to happen. So what is she learning? She's learning what is the length of one step for each of them. So how many steps should they take to reach that point? So she's learning the step size. So when she learns the step size, then she decides. Her intelligence tells us how many steps should they take to reach that goal. And for her to learn what is the step size, she needs data. Let's just say I take 10 steps. She will take the average of the 10 steps and decide that, okay, one step is going to be this much length and I have this much distance to cover. So how many steps do I need? So that is your machine learning ML. And from ML comes your AI. Your system has to learn to make decisions. It needs a base data. That's where comes your AI. And for ML, you need data, hell a lot of data. That is your big data, data analytics. Now what happens is there is so much data. So right now sitting in this room, I cannot count how many of you have sent how many WhatsApp messages. All of you have sent. Now all these WhatsApp messages, let's just say I want to find out how many of you spoke about this event. So these are the parameters I want to know. So that data analytics, what it gives me is, in the last 1 hour, out of 200 students, 20 students have sent 15 messages about this event on WhatsApp. So with this data, I will use machine learning to say or tell AI that now these 15 students, let's say the hall is going to become 2,000 students. How many of them are going to be on WhatsApp and what do I want to do with that? So in this way, what happens is she was your AI system. So her eyes were the data points. She was measuring what is the step size. Then once she got the information, her brain, the AI system. So with that, she decided how many steps they have to take. Now, in real world, what happens? For me to get data from anywhere in the world, I need IoT, that is Internet of Things. So what it does basically is from anywhere, any point, any type of data, everything comes to my server. The server can be anywhere in the world. And now from this server, what happens? I have a lot of data. Now from this lot of data, I want to find out critical data, data that matters to me. And next level comes, that is your big data or your data analytics. And from the data that matters, we filter and it goes to AI, ML, which is artificial intelligence and machine learning to learn. In simple English, machine learning is nothing but getting knowledge, learning. And AI is nothing but prediction. So in English terms, you can say predictive analysis. And finally, now, she knows that they have to take one step each. But then she communicated to them saying that you should take one step. And that is again where IoT comes in, where you convey the information, convey the action point, and it gets done. So in future, when any company does anything that is actionable and realistic, it takes a different set, a huge bunch of engineers with a different skill set to act upon it. The first one being IoT, then comes your data scientist, and then comes your AI ML expert, again back to IoT. Now a simple example which I actually saw as a joke was there were two engineers in the US. So one of them actually got an ad for temporary accommodation and a fire extinguisher when he was at office. This was a Facebook ad. Now when you look back and see why he got this ad, he analyzes. I think my Nest fire sensor has gone off. So Google is giving me an advertisement for a temporary accommodation and a fire extinguisher. So what has actually happened is he has home automation, which is IoT. And as part of his home automation, what happened? A fire went off. The fire sensor has found out that there is a fire. So immediately it is saying, okay, weed gali. Then what is it doing? It is saying, okay, these are all ads where you can find accommodation for now. And meanwhile, for next time, buy an extinguisher and keep so you won't be in this problem. So step one, Google's IoT home automation kit has sensed a fire. Second, it has known that this kind of fire, this person is away. So by the time something happens, the house is gone. It has been learned. Next, when a fire happens, what should I do? Call the fire people, the fire squad, and also take alternate measures. And intelligently, what Google is now doing, they know that he needs something. So using AI, they have found out, and now they're saying that once a person is going through such kind of a fire, they're going to need accommodation, and they're also going to need an alternative measure. So immediately, it's giving him ads. So this is the kind of level which a company like Google can go to, because Google knows everything about you, starting from where you are right now, how much you spent, what is your travel kind of a plan, everything Google knows. That is a company like Google. Let us take it a little bit lower with a company in healthcare. Now imagine a patient in the ICU. So what is it that they would need? What can AI, IoT, ML and big data do in the medical industry? So let's just say you're on a heart monitoring apparatus. Now ideally what happens even right now, when your pulse is way below normal, there is a system to alert, and nurses, doctors close to you, they do come really fast. But what if you can predict even before the heartbeat goes below normal? So how is it possible? So you have a wearable device that stays close to your heart and it keeps measuring your heartbeat. And over time, it learns your trends. So at what point, if he runs, what is his heartbeat? If he sleeps, what is his heartbeat? If he stands, what is his heartbeat? So there is a correlation of data. So when you're doing some specific activity, it understands, okay, this is his normal. And if it goes below this, for this duration of time, something is wrong. Then let me take an action. So the first part, data analytics and machine learning has been done. AI, what it is doing is, when the person's heartbeat goes below normal, immediately it triggers medical attention. And even before you lose a person, you have action being taken and the life being saved. So what traditionally might have been that, we are so sorry, later go to antinga, can now be, you have brought them much before time. That is what AI, IoT, ML and big data can do for us. In every field, right from even factories. We're talking about Industry 4.0, where one person can run an entire factory powered by robots. It's just like you can send a WhatsApp message to the factory saying, make 40 cars today. That is the kind of the world we're moving towards. And as a student, I would definitely say, like a panelist wonderfully shared, now is the best time. You are at the stage when the industry is maturing into future tech. There's a lot of opportunity. The biggest thing which everybody in industry wants are skilled professionals. That is what everybody is eager for. And like you rightly shared, people are ready to pay provided there is talent. So if you have the talent, the skill, I am sure that you have a wonderful future, because every company has to now go into AI, IoT and big data. Otherwise, what happens? It's just the story of Nokia all over again. You don't innovate, you don't grow, you perish. So every company is now on the hunt to go to the next level, and they need the right talent, right? So can all of you stand up, please? Can you raise one hand? Can you all clap with one hand? No, I said clap. Not possible, right? No? So I take this opportunity to congratulate the management on the wonderful infrastructure. And like ma'am has rightly shared, it takes two hands to make a sound. So please clap for the management for the wonderful initiative that has been taken. The first hand has been extended. Now it is upon all of you to make use of the opportunity, the equipment, the tools, because I've been to so many colleges and I'm really impressed with management's vision and the effort they're taking in terms of the infrastructure, the collaboration, and the thought process. So wishing you guys all the best and thank you so much.
We'll go for it. Before that, may I request Lena Emmanuel ma'am to talk about like how to turn your ideas in AI into products and customize them.
Hello, everybody. Thank you so much, first of all, to the Karpaka management for having me here. It has been a great experience, and seeing all the projects which you displayed, it has been an enlightening experience as well. Let me start off with talking about what we are building. I'm the CEO of Brainsight AI, and as the name suggests, we are looking at this wondrous organ called the brain, and it has more than 100 billion neurons, and it takes more than 20% of your total body energy while representing less than 5% of its mass. Now, these neurons in the brain are constantly firing together, communicating together, even while you are in a resting state right now. In fact, what neuroscientists like my co-founder, Dr. Rimchim Agarwal, has found, that it is this resting state of your brain that takes up 95% of your brain's energy. When you're doing a task, say, let's say, like I'm speaking right now, or maybe you're walking, that's just a 5% spike in the energy of your brain. The rest 95% is spent on intrinsic activities of the brain. Now, what's really interesting about this is that this intrinsic activity of the brain has shown huge potential to be able to look at early signs of dementia, to be able to understand psychiatric disorders like schizophrenia, bipolar, major depression. And it also has huge potential in guiding neurosurgeons when they are conducting a surgery on a patient to be able to ensure minimal functional loss after the surgery. And this is because this intrinsic activity of your brain actually is the reason for your higher order functions. The way you pay attention, the way you take executive decisions, the way you interact with your family, who you are, the personality is really kind of a function of these intrinsic activities of the brain. So that's what we do. We essentially look at these 100 billion neurons talking to each other. We extract the signal. We analyze it using computational neuroscience methods. And we bring it back into the 3D space so that doctors can understand what we are saying. And it is a super exciting phase, which is why companies like Google, Microsoft, and Dassault Systems, we are part of these accelerator programs and are working very closely with them as we go along. So that's what we do. And now let me get on to the topic of the day, which is essentially how do you kind of bring your AI products into the market? How do you build products out of your AI methods? I'm going to talk about three things. The first one is really ambition. So every single panelist here, you will say, has been obsessing over a certain problem. So they would have spent days, months, hours thinking about how to build a team, how to snag a sale, how to convert these AI methods to a problem that they care about. So it's really hard to build a startup. It's really hard to convert your AI methods into a product, which is where I think ambition really helps. And that's what I saw when I saw all your projects out there. Ambition essentially, is important because it's just as hard to work on a small problem and make it into a product as it is to work on a hard problem and make it into a product. And so if you're ambitious, what you're going to do is really think about the harder problems and put all your energy into it. It's going to keep you excited. It's going to make you meet the best people out there who are thinking about these problems. It's going to help you build the teams that you want. So essentially, all of these AI methods that you are looking at, and you are, as he correctly pointed out, at the cusp of a very ambitious phase in our country's life. Please use these methods to address problems which you think are hard. AI can be applied to fashion, retail, warehousing, healthcare, anything. But essentially, if you want to make an impact with your life, take a hard problem and apply everything that you have right now, everything that you've developed, to those problems. The second thing that you need is discipline. Now, building an AI method into a product, there are lots of things that you need to get right. As I said before, you need to know how to, you need obsession with the customer. You need to figure out what does the customer want. You need to be able to figure out how to talk in a sales meeting. You need to do so many other things. So business is really a bunch of skill sets together. And I don't come from a business background, so all of these skill sets are things that I learned on the job, which means that it is learnable. All of you can actually learn all of these skills. But you need to kind of break it down into smaller pieces and in a very disciplined way kind of increase your talent in each one of them. And there are lots of frameworks available. There are lots of ways to think about it. But I will talk about one discipline that you really, two disciplines really, that you really need to kind of build in yourself while you're building your AI methods. One is an obsession with figuring out what is an actual life problem. I think this is really important because as you develop AI methods and you kind of try and figure it out how to apply it, you might lose the fact that nobody really wants this particular AI method in this form. What they want, they have a problem and they want a solution to it. And you have to make sure that you're going out and talking to people and never losing that focus. So that's the first skill set that you need to kind of develop in yourself. The second, which I think is very important in our company, is having the ability to hold strong opinions lightly. And what I mean by that is each one of you is spending years thinking about these AI problems. When you go out there, a customer might not want it in the way. They might not think in the same way. They might give you a completely different problem. If you are going to be heavily invested in the way that you think, right, this is how you need to be solving this problem, you're never going to get anywhere. What you need to have is this ability to respond to people, listen to them, and change your opinion if needed. And I think this has helped us in a lot of good stead because as we go along, and neuroscience is a very like evolving field right now. So there are lots of opinions and if you have to be right, you have to listen and you have to change your opinion quite frequently. So that's so as I said, that's the second thing I wanted to talk about, that you need discipline to be able to convert these AI methods into a product. And the two main ones are really customer focus and your ability to hold a strong opinion lightly. The last I would like to talk about is luck. And I think your management has really kind of paved the luck for you, really. So the fact that you have industry leaders coming here and speaking to you, we never had this. And I don't think I ever had the intelligence to reach out to industry leaders were back when I was in engineering college. The fact that you have all of these structures already built for you means that the path to luck has been kind of paved for you. Now it really depends on you to use your ambition and your discipline to walk on that path as you go forward. So with that, I would like to congratulate all of you and thank the management for building the future of India. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Now let's move on to the hot seat section and we'll have some question and answers from our live viewers and also from the audience here. We have a question, first question from the viewer. How is AI impacting automotive industry? What is the impact of AI on automotive industry?
So in the automotive industry, first and foremost, starting from understanding what is the time to make one car, to predicting when is the next chance of an incident to happen, to thereon saying what is the PPM, the what is the part per million that is going to become a failure in production. So every industry wants a zero PPM because more the failure, more the loss. And also methods in which they can actually address and reduce the time consumed for each part. Now for example, let's just say the sequence of manufacturing is 1, 2, 3, 4. And then you understand 1 takes so much time, 2 takes this much, 3 takes this much and 4 takes so much. Can I do it simultaneously? Or can I reverse the process where it is possible? Thereon, in the point of assembling. So you all know that even the cars that we drive, most of it is made by robots. Assembling, welding, fixing, painting, everything is made by robots. So in this, the training of the robot, so what is the best way to do this aspect of the project in the fastest time? Or what difference can we make? Or where is the chance of failure? Or when is the failure going to happen? Now for example, let's just say I want to understand this process was normally taking 3 minutes and suddenly it's taking 3.54. So which means there's some wear and tear happening in the robot. The robot might fail soon. So this predictive analysis and also estimation of when this car is going to come out, how many can I make today, and even the people. So we can understand based on the trends of attendance, trends of people on the shop floor, how is my performance going to be today? How many people are going to actually come in and perform? So it's not limited, but there is so much more where you can add AI into the automotive manufacturing industry.
Okay, if you talk about the automotive industry, all the companies starting from car manufacturers till the Boeing, everyone adopts AI. I'll give you an example, okay. Sometime back, you know, this feature is available in all the Ford cars. What they say is, if you give it, when you give it for a service station, they are collecting the records of all the services that is happening in any of the Ford models, and they are sending back to the factories. They are building a model and then analyzing, okay, this is a particular defect that is coming from plant A. And then only these plant is, you know, making the cars that is coming with this kind of defect. Then they go back to that plant and say that you have to rectify this so that the future cars will not be there. And again, each and every time, it's not just for the car, it's for any kind of, you all understand, like, when they do anything related with healthcare and in the airline industry, they take an utmost care of it. Okay, so the precision plays a very important role. Whenever there is a precision, whenever there is a human error that has to be, you know, we should not take any chance. In that case, people always see prediction as, okay, it's just, you know, guessing something. It's not guessing anything. You have an algorithm. You have some mathematics going behind. Yeah, I do accept that to some extent you have a black box, but everything is explainable to some extent at least. Okay, in my point of view, it is not just automotive industry. You take any industry. If you name any one industry which says they do not collect store or secure data, then they don't have AI. But in my opinion, I don't have any industry which states as of today, we do not have data. So wherever the data is, please understand one thing. In my point of view, always understand this is going to be a revolutionized technology. And as Adar said, you have to be very lucky and happy to be a student at this point of the era. And for the next 1 or 2 decades at least, AI will, you know, not just the AI, you can include big data, data analytics, you know, machine learning, deep learning, NLP, IoT, blockchain, cybersecurity, all these technologies will be there at least for the next 2 or 3 decades. And from my side, I would always recommend you to choose a domain so that you can practice it a little bit, you know, from the earlier stages rather than going at the end and then coming back to automotive or to any other industry. It's always better to start in the from the scratch. And you guys have our support always. Please feel free to ask your mentors, whomever you are mentoring with. They'll be more than happy to help you. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We have a second question from our live participants. How do you see AI role in climate change? What is the importance of AI in climate change? Do we already have a solution at this point? Role of AI.
There are the good part and the bad part. So the good part is I do know people who are working on using AI to help help in different aspects of climate change, in predicting climate change events. So let me talk about the one company which I do know very closely, which is looking at how do you use algorithms to predict the effect of climate change on companies. So let's say Amazon is looking at building new factories in new areas. How will that play out for them over time due to climate change? So there are people who are doing this for companies. There are people who are using a lot of prediction algorithms for governments to able to predict things. And that's the good side of it. There's also the bad side of it that AI has a lot of like the kind of data mining and the kind of work that you do has its own impact on climate change. That's the bad part. So I think these are some of the thoughts that I have. I don't know if others have, other panelists have other ideas.
Yeah, no, I think, I'm sure all of us have gone through, I mean, not you guys, but many of the people who've been come from a slightly older generation have known that weather reports wouldn't be very accurate at that point in time. You'd say it would rain, it would not. Or it would say it would not rain, it would rain. So we've all gone through that phase. But nowadays you see that the weather reports itself are becoming more and more you know, accurate in their own prediction. And what are they doing? They're actually modeling their predictions based on the past data that they've been accumulating over a period of time. So I think one is, of course, a very small example at a localized thing about weather, but I think climate change and the impact that it will then have on livelihoods, on rain patterns, on cropping patterns, all of these things are getting modeled in a much better manner thanks to a lot of data availability and our ability to use that data in a much better manner. And that's where I think AI is, of course, I mean, it's become so pervasive now that we may not even realize that there are certain AI systems at the back end crunching through all that data and giving you much more better predictions, much more better models. And that's becoming more prevalent right now. Right? I know it's kind of a generic answer because we both don't come from the climate industry, but from our own ringside view of what's happening around in the industry, we can kind of hazard a guess as to what's happening.
Thank you, sir. There is another question from biotechnology student. He wants to know like how biotechnology is connected to the Department of Artificial Intelligence.
Repeat the question.
Yeah. How is biotechnology and AI connected?
I think the connection is really strong. I think the next decade is really going to be about biotech startups. I think the next big frontier is the human body and how do you use AI to understand the human body much better. So I think there are so many different interfaces. Like I can talk about a couple which I am work, like I know of and I can vouch for it. So there is a whole industry cropping around brain-computer interface. So really looking at how do you use brain-computer interface for rehabilitation of patients. So that has the hardware aspect of it also, and it has the software aspect of it also, because you really need to know how you, so this is something that we work on. So essentially being able to analyze the resting state patterns of a person to be able to say that the electrical stimulation needs to be done here and not here. And then being able to use the brain-computer interface to actually do that kind of electrical stimulation. So these are some of the, some in my industry, but I also know of other people who are working on making better TB analytics, people like him who are working on such exciting problems. So I honestly think the biotech industry and AI industry are going to have huge convergences in the future.
There are multiple other sectors as well, but I think among all the sectors where AI is really making huge inroads, biotech is one of them, right? You talk about agriculture, you talk about medicine, you talk about life sciences, you talk about healthcare. It's just enormous uptake of AI in each of these spaces. So today you have smart agriculture, smart farming. You have, again, in the pharma industry, AI actually helping drug discovery in a way where the entire process of drug delivering one blockbuster drug to the market, which would normally take about 10 years and about $10 to $12 billion, is now crashing down to a few years only, and a substantial decrease even in the cost that goes towards discovering a new drug. Then we have, again, personalized medicines coming into play. So I think, you know, the answer to that question probably will take us hours to keep peeling layer after layer, but suffices to say that biotech is one area where AI is making huge inroads and will continue to do so for the next foreseeable future. So people who are in biotech space, again, you're in a great space.
Thank you, sir. There are a lot of questions rolling out from the live viewers. Mostly asked question is, do AI affect manpower in the industry?
Okay. So now, let's say, for example, there were 10 jobs in the industry. Now, what happens with AI? AI will move labor from unskilled to skilled. As simple as that. So let's just say, earlier we had a person who was lifting an object and fitting an object, that will be replaced. The future is going to be people who can program a robot to lift that object and place that object. The number AI will not take away jobs, robotics will not take away jobs, they will create new jobs. The traditional jobs definitely will be replaced. For example, a data entry job. So somebody was looking at a form and typing, that will go. The future is going to be, put this form under a camera, OCR, the characters are recognized and it comes into digital format. So the data entry operator will go. But a person who can program to do OCR and fill the form and make a decision with the details in the form, is this person eligible for a loan or no, that will come. There's going to be more jobs, but mind you, it's going to be skilled jobs.
Which have come out, which talk about the future of work, and you will see that the future of work is really about creativity. So the creative tasks are going to be the ones which are most valued. The repetitive tasks, as they said, are going to be the ones which are going to be phased out using all of these different technologies.
Thank you, ma'am. Any questions from our students? Yeah.
Good afternoon, dignitaries. Myself is Dharnish. I am an AI student, second year. My question is, which AI domain can enhance the employability skill?
Could you please repeat that?
Okay, fine. My question is, which AI domain can enhance our employability skills and how?
As far as I know, AI is a domain. That is my understanding. Under that domain, there are technologies. Now, for AI to happen, technically speaking, NLP is not AI. Okay? It is basically understanding, and so I would bring NLP more into machine learning than AI. Right? So, now, to tell you which domain of AI creates more employability, I don't think I can answer that. Because do you mean industry-wise or technology-wise? For example, NLP is what you mentioned.
I mean industry-wise.
Okay, so thank you for correcting me. So industry-wise, like all of us have already shared and the wonderful guests have already spoken, choose your passion, forget the industry. So it might even be the silliest of things. For example, even on social media, you can use AI to find out which are the kind of images, memes, jokes being liked more. Two, saving a person from a heart attack. Everywhere AI can be used. So what is your calling? Where is your passion? Like DGP sir had shared, though he was in a different career, his passion was in Hindi literature. So where is your passion? Passion plus skill plus industry willingness to pay is what we call in Japanese as Aikigai. It's like an intersection point of all the three. Passion, what you like to do, skill, what you're competent to do, and an opportunity that is willing to pay. So every industry has AI. Very simple, be industry agnostic. Don't say, I will go into automotive industry as an AI engineer because it pays more. Let me tell you, every industry is going to pay more for AI. So choose whatever you like, forget everything else. Thank you.
We have one more question from our live viewer, sir. What is the role of AI in cryptocurrency?
Okay. Very bad combination of cryptocurrency with AI. I'll tell you a story, okay? You all understand the basics of blockchain, okay? Which is a kind of a ledger or moving money without any kind of trace. Keep it in, you know, a simple way. Just imagine you are automating that, you know, what do you call, that money using an AI without any kind of trace. Bitcoin is not, you know, authorized in India as such. They are still fighting to get a proper approval. So, but there are countries which is using Bitcoin as a legal currency, but we aren't taking anything right now. The reason behind is, you are selling something to someone and someone is getting it from you and you are doing an interaction completely in a encrypted way. You can use 128-bit encryption or 256-bit encryption, that's fine, but you are doing an encryption. What happens if an AI is doing that without any trace buying all the things? It is very good as long, in my opinion, I would say if you want to do an AI in cryptocurrency, it's a good career, but it's not a combination that people will believe that too in any part of Asia Pacific. It's a kind of a lethal combination. The reason is already something is untraceable and you are adding an automation to an untraceable event, which makes it more, you know, complicated. That's my point of view.
Thank you, sir. One last question from our audience. Anybody else? She's a CSE graduate, and how can she work in the field of artificial intelligence?
Honestly, Varalakshmi, I think you are the best placed person to go for artificial intelligence after your degree, because you will have the basic grounding in the algorithms, in the mathematics of artificial intelligence. And I think that is a combination that I don't find very often in people. They are able to use algorithms without really understanding what it does, while you will be very, very well placed to think about the implications of the algorithm. So I honestly think you are very well placed to work in any industry that is your passion, as Uday said. Yeah.
We are running short of time. With this, we'll end our hot seat session. And I thank all the panelists for your patient answering all the questions. And I thank all the viewers in the live and the people sitting over here for your questions. Thank you so much. Yes.